That was so beautifully read, Charles. Absolutely magnificent. And it is, of course, one of Lovecraft's very poetic pieces. It was, in fact, too poetic for the readers of Weird Tales when it was first published in Weird Tales. The editor of Weird Tales wrote to Lovecraft and said that his readers really disliked The Silver Key. It was just too poetic. Part of the reason I became a writer of Lovecraftian fiction was because I love his poetic prose. And for my newest book that is going to be published in October, I have written a series of prose poem sequences, the longest of which is a 15,000 word piece called Uncommon Places. And it was inspired by Lovecraft's Commonplace book. This is what Derleth did. He used Lovecraft's Commonplace book with which to create his collaborations with Lovecraft. So that's going to be in my new book. I also have a sequence devoted to Edgar Allan Poe and one to Oscar Wilde. And I just want to, I'm in the mood to read some poetic prose, so I am going to read two portions from In Memoriam Oscar Wilde by W.H. Cudmore. Tread gently, let your footsteps make no sound. Your animated shadow flits among the solid stones as daylight dies in darkening sky. Soft, sad breath lingers in the aether at your mouth, afraid to sail too far from those lips that gave it life. Pray softly as you approach the place where she reposes. No need to shout to touch the ears of Christ, within whose magnificent arms she sits enfolded, her golden hair kissed by sacred lips. Such is the kingdom of Christ's realm. Remove the envelope near your breast and take from it the lock of her hair that you keep as remembrance. Kiss it with a sinner's mouth. Reach to steady your trembling form by holding onto the chiseled hand of the graven thing. Such is the realm of your mortality. Peace, peace, she does not heed your mask of woe. Grief is a mortal burden. Brush away your crystal tears and know your time will come. Your Savior knows your name, and he will call you to the happy realm of death, where hand in hand you will dance with Isola beneath the silver stars. So, when Wilde wrote De Profundis, he was obsessed with the image of Christ. And so I introduced that theme into that opening portion. Then it gets really kind of kinky and macabre, very decadent. But then I end it with another. Isola was Wilde's younger sister who died. I believe she was how old was she when she died? Was she 8 or was she 12? I cannot quite remember. Now, he used to keep a lock of her hair in an envelope with him. So, that was part 1. This is part 4. You walk through storm, your hand at your heart. You feel the faded flower in your buttonhole, the soggy green carnation that shreds and melts as you pull it free. Before you is the wide expanse of filthy air that somehow beguiles you, and as you near it, the tempest drains of violence. You stand a sodden thing on graveyard ground and watch the things that dance in fog around neglected tombs. You hear the steady clacking as hands of bone are clapped, which reminds you of the funeral rites of the Gourd people that you witnessed on the coast of the Côte d'Ivoire. You marvel at how the dense fog contains a kind of misty light that enhances sight. From out one intimate tomb, she dances toward you, the thing that wears your sister's hair. She has not completely lost her flesh, and the withered mask of skin covering her skull smiles at you, although too widely. Her rotting shroud floats in the fog that moves and whirls around her fragile form as black leaves fall from high black limbs. She capers around you playfully, and then she offers you the lily in her fungal hand, the flower that is the only living thing. You take the plant and touch it to your lips. Its potent odor spills into your face, your pores. You can taste it on your tongue. Your substantial mouth rips into the blossom's flesh, and the taste is delicious. You notice how pale are the hands that hold the rare, half-eaten bloom. And then you kneel to your sister and offer her the uneaten half. And as she takes it, you wind your frigid hands into her tarnished hair and brush away the black leaves that cling to it. "Isola," you whisper, but the sound of your phantom voice is muffled in the tempest now returned. The teeming, skeletonic horde whirl around you, coaxing you to join their fray. Your little sister smiles at the chaotic crew, takes your hand, and beckons you to stand. Together, you step into the dance. So, in memory of dear Oscar Wilde, another poet. I love poetry. And I love weird fiction. Just got a wonderful book, The Hounds of Tyndalus. Weird fiction by Lovecraft's friend Frank Belknap Long. The Hounds of Tyndalus is one of the finest Lovecraftian stories ever written by someone who was not H.P. Lovecraft. It's really great. So, I love it here at YouTube. I love being able to read my own fiction, and I love listening to people read so beautifully from H.P. Lovecraft, as Charles has graced us with this amazing and magnificent reading of that rare story, The Silver Key. Your voice, Charles, is enchanting. I'm gonna go listen to it again. I wish you all